me up there. Now that's the fix, that's my drug. That big round of applause. If I go up, can I have another one? How are you doing? Unique, uncut, best you can get. That's what I realised I was addicted to when I was 15. People banging their hands together and shouting. Yes, I am that shallow. I need a fix of that almost every day, you know? My wife thinks I was weaned too early. You know, why is it? Was it because we moved too much when I was a kid? I don't know, but I just need people to clap me. But it's great, I get that when I go to work. Does anyone else? Wouldn't it be nice to do the day's work, and as you left, people went, well done. To be honest, I think we need that, you know? It's one of the things that, you know, it's very obvious. But it's also, the trouble is when you stand here, it's pretty obvious when it all goes wrong. You know, one night we did a gig and people were booing. And I said to Phil, there's someone cheering. He said, no, they're cheering the people booing. But you compare that really rich, fulsome round of applause. Imagine if I come out here and I do like the worst song you've ever heard. Can you give me the most indifferent round of applause at the end of it? Okay, so I'm going to go, and that's why I miss you, darling. Don't need the swearing as well. That's terrible, isn't it? But imagine if you were one of those singer-songwriters and you poured everything into that song. It was names and dates and packed through it. It was about your whole life. You know, and you sang it and people just went, you know, and it's not just the song that they don't like, it's you as well. So I learned pretty early on, you know, singing the folk songs, where you can be other people. You know, I'd rather be other people in songs, because then you're slightly protected. Because if they don't like the song, it's not so much you. So it's one of those things, when songwriters get it all right, and there's that amazing unity of the person, the lyric, the vulnerability, there's nothing more powerful. But when it's awful, it's just like, I miss you, baby. You know, all that sort of stuff. So I thought the best place to get the big, big claps. Another one, please. Was to play rock and roll in London. So after Coventry, I went to Brighton for about 3 years. Paul Downes and Phil Beer were living there. As soon as I got there, the buggers left. And I did a couple of years, maybe 3 years, on the folk scene with Paul's older brother, Warwick, who's now living back down in East Devon. Fine double bass player. But by the time I must have been about 23, 24, the call of rock and roll and the big claps was really pulling me in. Because living that close to London, mate, you know, you should do this folky shit, you should be up there, you know, and all this sort of stuff. And I met some musicians from London, some management types, and I moved to London, and I formed a band. Based around my songs, a couple of real hardcore London rock and rollers, some West Country boys as well, Tim Dyke from Exmouth, Julian Dyke, who was Tim's brother. So we were in the band, we had short stories, we were called Total Strangers, we were called The Cheats. We had a proper manager, with a proper name, John Roseman, who had an office in Soho, and we did the whole pub circuit for about 6 years. The Greyhound, the Golden Lion, Half Moon Putney, Hope and Anchor, Bull and Gate, all those real rock and roll pubs, the Music Machine. We didn't get signed. And in those days, you used to care less about the 100 people clapping, and where's the A&R guy? Where's the guy from the record company? Because without that person, to pay for you to go to a studio, you couldn't even make the music. You know, you could record it on a cassette maybe, or on a tape at a rehearsal room, but it was that A&R guy, and a lot of those were sort of twisted guys who were failed musicians who sort of hated you anyway. You know, I work for EMI, you know. And you've got to be nice to them, because they're the key to the studio, that's the key to the demo, that's the key to take to the record company, and the record company's the key to the pluggers to take you to the promised land of radio play. So and you're at the end of this whole chain, you know, that works against you. And from that scene that we were playing, Dire Straits and Squeeze, they came from that pub circuit, maybe a year or two. So there was a pathway, but you had to have something very, very special, and we obviously didn't have it. And the band eventually broke up. But I had some fun in London for 6 years. You know, I had purple hair, I looked very wasted. I wore makeup and stuff, and occasionally learned how to jump up and down. And I learned how to be a pretend Cockney as well, you know. What am I different? These 4 young men is available. What happened again? I'm not. Stuff like that, you know. And yeah, moving on quickly. So anyway, this friend, he's a friend now, but at the time he was a manager. There was a difference. You need someone who's got real teeth. You need someone who's an absolute attack dog. But you hope that you never see that side of them. And it's impossible for them to be like that. You cannot have an attack dog that only licks your feet, you know. And eventually you see their nature. But John Roseman was the real deal. John was an agency. He represented loads of newsreaders and lots of famous people. He tried to buy Brighton and Hove Albion with his friends, you know, used to go out, you know, horse racing for days on end and helicopters. But his main job was as a video producer. His company produced Bohemian Rhapsody, which started off the whole video boom. And when we were in London, he was producing the Rhythmics and George Michael. And I got involved in some of the shoots, you know, as a sort of gopher. The Eurythmics, Sweet Dreams Are Made of This. I don't know if you remember, they're leading a cow around a boardroom. It's a disused post office in Oxford Street as a location. And it's a real scene. And they said to me, look, you're a fucking West Country boy, look after the cow. So I had to look after this bloody cow. And I was a body double for David Essex when he turned up late. Okay, Steve, that's enough. Bugger off. Never got on camera myself, but after about 6 years of this, the band broke up, as bands do, you know. And I moved back to the West Country, but I didn't want to go back to Exmouth because that was like farewell, suckers. I'm off to be famous. You know. Oh, you're back. It's like Scott at the Antarctic. Oates, you're back. bit surreal that one. Anyway, this is a song I wrote that puts all that into, you know, 3 minutes. It's called Be Lucky, which is sort of the key to it. And still you meet people all the time and they say to you, you know, you've been slogging around for years and just one song, it's all it needs. Because I had a friend who knew a friend who had somebody who knew Sting, and the next minute they're not with us, you know, they're living elsewhere, they've made a fortune. It's like saying to people, you know, one lottery ticket's all it needs for happiness. You know, if you just keep buying lottery tickets, that's all it needs. And I always say to young musicians, there's not actually the lottery ticket song waiting somewhere. All you've got is the trip to the shops. So you may as well make it a nice trip to the shop. And what better trip to the shops could I have had than coming here today? Because I get my fix, you know, I get paid. Hear this all the time, you know, you're just one song. Take you away from all this squalor. You know, last night I did a house concert, Miranda's in Totnes. Tomorrow I'm off to Bradford-on-Avon, lovely little show. And I'm staying at Seasoncoke Manor with Josh for 2 nights, with a friend, and finishing Chipping Norton. What a lovely trip to the shops this week will be. If only it had started off with us beating Bath in Gloucester, it would have been perfect. But anyway, that's going to happen on Friday, so... Thank you. But I looked up to a man. He never let me down. But he said, son, do you want your music sold? You'd better be smart or lucky. They want it all. Space inside they need to fill. Friendship they're prepared to kill. Hunger is their guiding light. They claw and scratch, they push, they fight. Wanna be lucky. And now I've come so far. People ask for clues, they say, how have you found the peace you had? It was one night in a bar, young man on the move, he said, so what's the one thing that you've learned? And I said, be smart, if you can't break the mold, break the road, you will make friends of money. Ah, but if you would be king, be cruel. 'Cause how much do you want the prize? Will you freely sacrifice pride in your integrity for fortune and celebrity? Break the rules, don't be cruel. One of the keys for me of doing this show was to have these headsets. This is like Madonna wears, you know. I try and get filter wearing so he can do his dance moves. But you have to remember you're wearing them. I said, I've got a range of about 100 yards. First night in Torrington. It didn't go very well the first set. I walked off and what a miserable bunch of people. I could hear my voice resounding around it, so I had to run out and go, only joking. Well, I was. So anyway, I was 32 when the band broke up, and I didn't want to move back to Exeter, so we moved to the wilds of Dorset, a place called Marshall Vale. My mum was evacuated there in the war to a farm in Bettiscombe. And we used to go back when we were kids, so it's the most beautiful part of the world. No main roads, no big towns, very, very remote. And it sort of like hid away for a couple of years, you know. It was, I suppose I thought, I'd had a go at music, it hasn't worked out, what am I going to do now? You know, I didn't see this coming, really, at the time. I threw myself into sort of country life, really, did up a cottage. I drank a great deal of beer with the local guys in the pub called The Fox. I played darts for a couple of years. I had no idea how much beer you can drink when you're playing darts. 8-9 pints. One night, this guy said, here, give the punk rocker a snake bite. So what's that? I'll try it. Big mistake. Snake bite. And I think it was whiskey and vodka and black currant. I can't remember what was in it. I should never have driven home in those days. I just don't. I take no pride in it. I'm just making a statement of fact. Luckily, in the lanes, it's so narrow, you can sort of like go from side to side. And yeah, I got to know lots of the lads, you know, the firemen and the farmers and the the sort of bike riders, all that sort of crowd, all those guys that you find in the countryside having fun off the record gigs, you know, little barnyard stuff. But I wasn't playing any music, really, to be honest. I thought I'd had a go at that. I taught a bit of guitar. The young PJ Harvey came for lessons when she was 17, Polly Harvey. Now she's a mega, mega star. I didn't spot that. She came up the road with her mum, Eve, and said, the deal was, Polly's dad's got a quarry at Ham Hill. I gave Polly 12 lessons in exchange for topsoil and hamstone. And I taught her some of these big sort of chunky chords that I'd learned playing rock and roll. Which I've heard, you know, she does that sort of thing brilliantly. And I taught for a while at the local comprehensive, Bannister. I picked up this education certificate in Brighton. I have no idea how I managed that. I never turned up. I must have been. Anyway, I got this certificate and I taught about 2 days a week, which was quite nice. I quite liked that, actually. But I wasn't playing music, basically, at the bottom line. And then, after about a year of this, over the hill to my rescue rode the imposing figure of Phil Beer. And he said, look, we should do some folk clubs, you know. What about the songs that we used to play in East Devon? He had some time off between the Albion band and I had time off, basically. So we did a lot of folk clubs. Well, not, maybe did about 25 in that first year. Cold winter of 87, we made a cassette, you know. And we didn't really do much more until about 2 years later. And we met this agent in Bridport, a guy called Peter Wilson. And Peter said, look, my patch is Portsmouth in the east and Plymouth in the west. So do you want to go and do some pub gigs? And we said, all right. You can imagine some of the places we played. Saturday night pubs in Gosport, you know. Half the audience bikers, the other half sort of sailors, all staring at each other with undisguised longing. You know. And we were the duo, you know, in the corner. And there's no good standing there and going, "'Twas pleasant and delightful with summer's morn." You know, you have to play sort of rock and rolly stuff. And it's no good even being sort of like, "I'm so sad and lonely since she left me." You know, you've got to have attitude when you're playing in a pub. Otherwise, you do become background music and it's very dispirited. But if you stand in the corner and you go, "I ain't saying nothing, baby, but you ain't gonna check no more." You just make up the lyrics, no one cares. Because you're playing the blues and the rock and roll. People go, "Nah, quite like these boys." You know, "As I was going over the Cork and Kerry Mountain." Then we did all that stuff. I wrote the Galway Farmer so I didn't have to sing Kilgarry Mountain again. "I've been a Wild Rover for many a year." I'm not going to start because you're all going to join in. I think, I wish we were singing stuff like that. But then, and this is the secret, we started putting my original songs in that context. So we do some blues and some Stones and some Elvis. Then we do one of my songs. But it would have those rhythms. It wouldn't have the folky rhythms. It would have, you know, I wrote a song called Cars. It was like, "You know I gotta put on to drive to the coast, 50 miles an hour at the most. Feeling good, the weather is fine. Reach the main road. What do I find? The cars. Far as the eye can see, there's cars. Would have been there hours ago, but there's miles and miles and miles of cars." You know, you go back there 8 weeks later, and the guys would go, "Hey, okay, here, mate, do that chorus song, like that one." You know, so you're getting your own songs fit, but in a pub, in the same way like the Irish and the Scots were playing stuff in pubs. You go to a theatre or a festival and all your stuff has been honed, you know. Rhythms, you know. "Gotta keep the wolf from my door. I've seen his face, I've seen his claw." You know, that whole diddly rhythm, sort of like that. Not at all folky, you know. "Say I remember when we used to sit." You know, "No Woman, No Cry." All those songs, and then you do your own song in that context. And as I say, all that material gets tighter and tighter and tighter. And our first festival breakthrough after about 3 years of this was 92 at Cambridge Festival. They said the graveyard spot is on the main stage, which was outside of the marquee in those days, at 12 o'clock on a Sunday. About 3,000 people milling around. And we just came out in a things like introducing the song. My name's Steve Miller, this is Philbit. Can you hear us at the back? You know, all that stagecraft stuff that you learn in the pubs. But none of our friends who had been playing in quiet, respectful folk clubs had access to it. I mean, they would do things like they'd be tuning for ages and ages. And they'd go, and the chorus goes, it was on the 14th of July, Bothered and she passed by. As I said, it was on the 14th. Imagine doing that in Union Street, you know. You can't. So we were gig fit, you know, and we were sort of like, we were on our way at that point. The very, very last pub gig we ever did was Stubbington Social Club, Leon Solon, just outside Gosport, February the 8th, 1994. As you can tell, the date is burned upon my memory. That's the last free admission gig. And that's the big breakthrough. And that's one thing that Ralph Mattel said to us. You have to stop doing free gigs at some point. And it's a big leap between that and admission, you know, admission venues. And Leon C, that social club, I remember we'd finished off our set and we're just about, you know, there wasn't really any applause, but the landlord staggers out. He goes, boys, I always do Danny Boy with the turn. Here, mate, mush it was. Mush, pick up your fiddle. He's, oh, Danny Boy. You know, play it. Oh, I'm going to play it. And Phil and I were looking at each other going, never again, never again. And it was, indeed, never again. But it was great learning all those songs. You know, it was great having all those gears with the sort of bigger voice that I developed and the chunkier chords. And things like, I can see clearly now the rain has gone. I can see all obstacles in my way. Gone are the dark, dark clouds that have me blind. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day. You know, things like, I see a band rising. I see trouble on the way. I hear hurricanes and lightning. I see a bad moon day. I don't go out tonight. They're bound to take your life. There's a bad moon on the rise. Don't go out tonight. They're bound to take your life. And you get to measure your songs against those things, you know, against the standards like that. And on the whole, don't get there, but you get close, you know, on some of them. And so we were up and running. We were gig fit, you know, we were really gig fit as a duo, full time as a duo in 1994. For the first time in my life, full time professional musician, in the sense that I was only earning my living from playing music. I had to replace my teaching income of £500 a month for 2.5 days a week, 2 days a week. And three gigs did it, you know, three gigs did it. So we were up and running, Phil left the Albion Band and all that sort of stuff. So we were flying. And it was at this point that we came across, I suppose, Ted Hughes, Martin Carthy, Bob Dylan. You've got to add David Oddie to it. This wonderful man, the late David Oddie, who makes these instruments. Because this is what one of the things that set us apart, as well as the rhythms and the way we were playing, the sounds that we could make from these instruments. And David, for those of you that have never met David, he's your classic working class Exeter. The bastard said he'd come round and fucking turn up, but I said, wait, no bloody morning, because the God botherers came up and said, don't fuck her off. That's one of the point that I said. I think he said it. It's the space for our see the bastard cold, isn't it? David was like that. And he died last year at the age of 86. And he would go to his shed at the top of his garden at Whipton, and out of this little shed, these extraordinary instruments would emerge. You know, I don't know how he developed this gift. He worked for the post office all his life. Originally, I think the age of 14 or 15, just putting up telegraph poles all over Devon. Then he became one of these guys who could mend things and take things to bits. And he's a legend. He's still a legend locally amongst those guys. But as a furniture maker, he suddenly was able to make these amazing instruments. And this one in particular became our secret weapon, the cello mandolin. Again, if I play just the open strings, it's in that mode, that similar to the dadgad tuning. It's no major or minor thirds. It's great for the folk songs because they're often in these modes. And I could also play these big chunky. Phil, if you listen to these, you know, there's the space up there to decorate, you know. Someone said once, show of hands is interesting. Steve builds the song, Steve builds the house and Phil decorates it. Well, they're not always there when the work's being done. So I think it's great. Also, these pickups, the thump you make, all the same in every instrument. These are Ashworth pickups. Al Jones lived in Exmouth and he moved down to Cornwall. Died about 15 years ago. He took his secret to the grave. They're made from the elements that you have in cat's eyes. A pressure, not proper cats, but in the room. Pressure produces a small electrical charge. And he wrapped them in a type of silicone and a type of rubber sheath, and then they're under the pickups. So when you play with the heel of your hand, you can hear that thump, which again is like a bass drum and a heartbeat. I was doing this song in Germany once, tapping. I think it was the yoke. And a guy said, yeah, which sort of digital percussion are you using? I said, that one. Don't find this amusing. So, and the other thing, you can play the tunes in it, and you can make this also sound very sort of exotic and as if it's from another tradition. Even when you're sitting in a room, a silent room that's got reverb in it, and you're just noodling away like that, it gives you ideas for songs. And you know, all thanks to David. And over the years, so many of his expressions have become legendary. You know, he came to see us play at the Great Hall, and a huge crowd about 10 years ago. I said, "Do you enjoy the gig?" He said, "Perfectly honest, no, I didn't." He said, "I don't mind Phil's fiddling, but your songs can be a bit dreary." And he was a bit hard on people that got precious about these instruments. It's just tittered bit of wood with wires on it, isn't it? For him, it's an art. It's an artifact. It's a tool, and I agree. I agree. It's not a work of art, and I don't think standing up here. I don't think people who call themselves artists are just often excusing the fact that they're late and behaving badly. You know, bollocks about artistic temperament. It's just crap, really. I think you can look at someone's work and say that was an artist, that life, but not here because I'm an artist and I tend to be, you know, a pain in the ass. But that's just it. It's a craft, I think. It's like storytelling. It's much healthier to look at things like that. And that's how David certainly looked at it. Buggers get precious about early things. This guy took a cello mandolin back to him after about 6 months. He said, "Dave, I'm going to have to return it because it just doesn't sound like it does when Steve might be in Philbia." Because that's because they're fucking professionals and you're not. Another guy, one of his famous, you know, guy took a guitar back because the string rattled. He said, "Listen, Dave, every time it rattles, it doesn't do well, play it then." I like that attitude. So, the cello mandolin, big thumpy sound. Working in the rain, coming to the good, your country life, or Santiago, all these songs came out from the heartbeat and the thump. These other ones here, this little baby, the same rosewood and the same pine as the other two of these others. It's a tenor guitar. I met this young shepherd boy from Dartmoor called Seth Lakeman. 12 years ago, we did a tour. I think it was Seth's first solo tour since he left playing with his brother and Cara Dillon and with young Jenowitz from North Devon. And Seth played this tenor guitar every night as well as the fiddle. Very sweet sound. These are tight instruments, tight strings. You know, this is that isn't actually a G, the note, but it's an A string, A, B, C, tuned up to its tight. And you've got the same chord shapes as the tenor, as the cello mandolin. It's got a very sort of clean and sweet sound. But Seth plays it almost like a rhythm guitar player. It's almost like folk underwater. Sort of rock and roll riffs, isn't it? But again, he looks like a rock star, but he's a folky through and through. You know, that's in his DNA. For Phil and I, it wasn't like that. We had to sort of acquire these instruments. Because what is a native English instrument? If you play English acoustic music, the melodeon is from Germany and the fiddle and that. So our job, we are like the Francis Drake of musicians. We have to nick from everybody else. And I think that's what English musicians do really well. So there you go, that's the tenor guitar. And this other little instrument, it's called a quattro. We worked with some Chilean exiles in the early 90s. Big bear of a man, Mauricio Venegas. He led a group called Key Man 2. There were lots of bands around in the early 90s. You know, if I look back at After Hours and La Cucina and E2, and they're still going, but and all the South American bands. There were loads and loads on the Art Center circuit. Very few to be found these days. It's sad, the lack of bands. It's got so much more expensive to run a group. And there's so much less money to be made from CD sales these days. Because people are streaming, that's the way it is. I'd say another 2 years, it won't exist even as a form. It's amazing how quickly it's ending. Luckily, the folk audience still likes to have something that they can take away and have signed. But generally speaking, I look at Topsham, my wife and all her friends in their 40s, probably used to buy an album a week. Hear something on the radio, whether it's Ed Sheeran or Seth, whatever, Amazon through the door the next day. Now, It's bloody Alexa. Alexa, don't play Show of Hands, I'm sick of them, you know. Alexa's in the corner streaming everything. But anyway, this little instrument, these guys, Kimantu, it's called a quattro. It's like a ukulele in a sense. In the sense that there's a string that's almost out of order. You go dum, bum, bum, dum. You'd expect it to go up, but it drops. It drops an octave. So an ordinary guitar shape, you have that note out of sequence, and it's a very sweet sound. Again, it's got the Ashworth pickup that gives you that thump. But the way that the South Americans play it, of course, is... very rhythmic sort of way, and it was great listening to their rhythms and trying to sort of pick up on some of those. This piece of cherry here, the cherry wood, is designed to protect the softer pine from their fingernails, because they do this thing where you... I can't do it. They build up their nails with super glue and tissue paper. And when you're standing next to them, there's bits of nail flying out. It's like, I can do it this way. Get a similar sort of rolling effect. Again, lots of songs are born on this instrument. To hear how they affect the nature of a song, I'm going to play the same song on all four instruments. And I'm going to try and change over in between verses. So what you have to imagine at those points is the ghost-like figure of Phil Beer doing some violin or slide guitar as I pick up one of the instruments and go from one to the other. I'll start off on the quattro, then I think I'll go to the tenor guitar, then I'll go to the guitar, and so I need to have a plectrum ready to go. I shall put that there, and right, good. It's a song called Make the Right Noises, which is a new song of mine. It is a slightly personal song in the sense that it's not folksy, and it's not about a narrative song. It's an emotional landscape song where someone is saying to the other, look, make the right noises, just, I know that you want to go, but can you just pretend that you don't? That's that sort of thing. And it's got a line that this American guy said to me once. He said, Steve, I think sincerity is the most overrated virtue. And I thought, that's a great line. I've been waiting to put that into a song for ages. It's true though, isn't it? I'm being sincere, why don't be? You say one thing, but I hear another. When you write friend, then I read lover. When you hold all the cards, you make the choices. But say anything, make the right noises. Say anything, make the right noises. When you hold all the cards, you make the choices. Say anything, make the right noises. The least said, then the soonest mended. I hope your better judgment lies suspended. And in the dark my fading hope rejoices. Say anything, make the right noises. Say anything, make the right noises. Cause in the dark my fading hope rejoices. Say anything, make the right noises. There's a little time before you go, and there's nothing you can say. stated of all the virtues, sincerity must be the most overrated. Of all the virtues, sincerity must be the most overrated. Overrated. If you're remaining unspoken for a while, my heart might not be broken. So talk to me and don't listen to your voices. Say anything, make the right noises. Get a bit tense some nights. Did you teach with Gareth Thomas in Exmouth? Griff Thomas, do you mean? Griff was my form teacher. Yeah, Griff, the most extraordinary man. He lives in Topsham. I've seen him occasionally. Very, very eccentric, exotic creature. Some of the when I taught for a while, I suddenly realised that all the crazies that we met as kids, on all sides of the spectrum, to psychopathic, to fantasy, you know, absolute. One guy at Heel School, I was there for 3 years, I was there, he said, you know, I tried to kill Hitler, and I tried to stab him with a poisoned umbrella. You know, he was at Cuthbert Collins, a complete fantasist. He used to make stuff up. And we used to sit there, really, sir? Yeah. Had a fight with a crocodile in the jungle. And then there was a slightly sleazy ones. I realised in the staff room, everyone knew them. Everybody knew what was going on. It was not a mystery. And because we thought we were just on the receiving end of crazy people, but yeah, it was an interesting time. Yeah, I knew Griff very well. I still know him very, very well. The most amazing guy. I was in lots and lots of his plays, and in lots of them, all the guys were wearing tights, and they were very exotic medieval pageants. Yeah, it was quite a... could you do a... Oh, Captain Pugwash, you mean... Would you be accompanied by Seaman Staines? No, I'm not, I didn't read a second. I'm not going to go over that. On the subject of haunting, who would you like to be haunted by? Well, that's a bit of a question, isn't it, really? Kate Bush would be nice, but that's hey, what? What? No, I'm thinking of Wuthering Heights. Yeah, that's true. But can I only be haunted by dead people? Yeah, that's true, actually. Yeah, I didn't think it through, did I? No, well, I don't know. Hedy Lamarr sounds like the most extraordinary one. And lately in the paper, not only she was the most amazing actress, but she invented GPS location systems that guided torpedoes. I just thought she was like a Hollywood name. Check out, yeah, I'd like to be haunted by Hedy Lamarr, please. As long as she didn't guide torpedoes. Anyway, moving on. The Wake the Union Band. Yeah, it would be nice to. The Wake the Union Band was me and Miranda, Phil Henry and Hannah Martin, and Rex Preston, and Leonard and Matt. When Phil was off sailing, we did a season. It was great, great good fun. I'd like to do that with more. Do we have plans to play at the Royal Albert Hall? Every 5 years we do that, so 4 years' time if we're all walking. Ed Sheeran or Newton Faulkner? Oh, that's an interesting question. Met Ed Sheeran about 6 years ago. Well, met him, he was in the same campsite. You know. What a lovely, lovely chap. One of the nicest guys. I only, in passing, and the reason I knew this is he had agreed to do some festivals for £500. This was long after Class 18 when all that was the number one and he was the hottest property. He still did them because he said he would. And it's exactly what you'd expect. Same with, I think, Chris Martin seems to be a really, really nice guy. I know his dad, Anthony, but when my brother died, we got a request to Anthony, because my nephew, Robbie, who was 16 at the time, was going to be in the audience at the Etihad Stadium. And my sister said to Chris Martin's dad, look, any chance he could dedicate Fix You to Robbie Knightley? And sure enough, in front of 120,000 people, this is a song for young Robbie Knightley out there called Fix You. So the fact that that request got through says everything about an organisation and a structure. It really says that there's a sort of thread of humanity running through it. So, although whatever you think about their music, there's obviously some real people at the heart of that. So, have you ever considered replacing Phil and Miranda with a loop pedal? Yeah, that would be brilliant, wouldn't it? Ed Sheeran's got the loop pedal. It repeats what you go. So you go... And you can do the three-part harmonies and loop it around. No, I wouldn't. Phil drives me loopy enough already. Da-da! Do you find music theory a help or a hindrance? If I could read or write, then I wouldn't really know. I can't read or write. Never could. Do you know the difference between a mixolydian minor with a flat fifth or a Morris minor with a flat time? That's really good. That's very well constructed, that. Have you ever looked at Phil and thought, my God, it's the Grim Reaper? What a terrible thing to say. What a terrible thing to say. Talk about instruments, words at first. That's fine. What's this one? What's the most memorable subject someone has suggested to write a song about? Oh, can I tell you this? The guy I wrote The Dive about, Dave Curley, Dave and his dad, he told me about the way that they recovered captain of a ship off Tynemouth about 4 years ago. The ship went down, some of you may have remembered it, a ship from Exmouth, and there was an exclusion zone around it because it had to be investigated, and the Coast Guard didn't allow anybody to get down to recover the body. But that meant no funeral, no closure or whatever. So the guys just unofficially got together a little gang of divers and went down, and after 3 weeks got the guy's body back. I think that's the most amazing idea for a song. And you could make a verse about leaving your comrades at the front, or, you know, not someone left behind. It doesn't have to be military. Then another verse could be about, I won't leave you behind. Don't worry, whatever happens, I'll always come for you. Lovely poetic idea in the heart of that. So I think I'm going to work on that as a sort of second part of the dive. Yeah, I'm going to press on. So anyway, these lovely instruments. And the Ted Hughes and the Martin Parthies and the Country Boys, all these songs. But it's nice sometimes to dip your toe into the American landscape, simply because their place names are so brilliant to sing about, you know, in a way that ours aren't. You know, I wrote a song about Yeovil, got into trouble with the mayor. He accused me of portraying Yeovil in a negative light. The incident in the chip shop genuinely happened. We were threatened by this guy, I believe he's called Vince. You know when there's like a really scary bloke, but he's got the tattoo and the cut here and the talent and all that, but he's about 45, you know, and really, you know, like, it's difficult, you know. It really happened in the chip shop. It's odd with Phil. One of the questions was, what would you do? I'm either very, very cautious, very watchful, and I'm aware that something, and we've got to go, or I'm completely lost it. I've got no bit in the middle. You know where some people go, excuse me, do you mind not stopping doing that? Yeah, thank you. And they just know it's quite safe. I'm either very wary, very worried, or I'm in a place I just don't know where it's going on. And it's funny, I've got to say, no middle ground. Phil doesn't seem to be frightened of anything. You know, he's got a complete recklessness. And I'm going, Phil, just look away, Phil. So that's the way we differ like that. Phil has lost it with people in the dressing room, guys who come in shouting and screaming, and I'm thinking, well, he has got a point. Get out of my fucking dressing room. And they go, and when they see Phil anger angry, they laugh, move quickly. It's really amazing. About once every 3 years, he loses it, and it's really impressive. You know, I'm always trying to be political and trying to manage it. Or, as I say, I'm completely out of it. But. So anyway, we toured with these Americans, some wonderful Americans over the last 10 years. Richard Schindel, what a fantastic songwriter from New Jersey. You know, when he sings about crossing the Ohio state line, or looking out of sort of like the, I don't know, the Golden Gate Bridge, you're there, you're almost there in his film, you know. Oh, what a landscape. And Leonard and Matt from New Jersey and from Canada, they talk about touring and crossing the state lines, and they were in, so, Macon County. Oh, wow. And I've tried writing songs, but you imagine I could write a song like, gotta leave New Orleans, honey, gonna head to New York City. As opposed to, gotta leave Taunton, baby, I still dream about Plymouth. Why is it funny though, isn't it? Maybe to an American ear it sounds sort of like quite cool, but you know, not sure it does, not sure it does. Maybe it's because those places have been in so many films, you know. And we toured with Richard in the Midlands, you know. Our place names, you know, Piddle Hinton and Lower Wallop, you know. How can you write a song about that? We're driving by Loughborough. He said, hey, Looga Baroga Baroga. Sounds cool. I said, it's Loughborough, Richard. Wow, that's amazing. I'll sing you a song by Bruce Springsteen because I think he captures that landscape better than anyone. And it's really nice, like I do in a folk song, to become an American. I sort of sing an American accent, you know. There you go, there's the police arrive. There's a damn squad car on the highway there. Can you fix that there, bugger Josh?
Give me a minute.
Yeah, give me a minute. It's got to turn it off and reset it. Here we go. There you go.
No, not yet.
No. Give it another go. It's these LED lights. Yeah. They have the benefit of not ever getting hot, but...
All working.
I tell you what, I mean, I could do... Cars on the highway, the headlights flash by me. Caught this morning, the house was cold, the furnace wasn't burning. I went inside in my old Ford, but engine she won't turn in. Giving out hard lessons lately, cause we ain't learning. We're the same sad story, that's a fact. Taking one step up and two steps back. Bird on a wire outside my motel room. Well, she ain't singing. There's a girl in white outside a church in June, but the church bells ain't ringing. Sitting here in this bar tonight. And all I'm thinking, I'm the same old story, the same old guy. Taking one step up, two steps back. It's the same thing every night. Who's wrong, honey, who's right? I get mad and I slam the door. Another battle in our dirty little boy. Look at myself and I don't see the man I hope to be. Somewhere down the line, I slipped off track. Taking one step up and two steps back. did she send him? Ah, she looked at Mary and me. Honey, I'm just pretending. Last night I dreamt you were in my arms. Music never ended. And we danced till the evening sky turned black. Taking one step up and two steps back. Oh, we danced till the evening sky turned black. We took one step up. Circle, I'm going to play you one of the songs I heard Martin Carthy play that night in Sidmouth when I was 14. It was really nice that Sidmouth made Phil and I patrons about 5 years ago of the festival, what sort of encouraged me to learn folk songs. And some other notable local awards. In East Devon, we're as well known as people who are really well known in the real world. But it's not that difficult to get in the Express and Echo in the Exmouth Journal. You know, they're often short of column inches, so we find our ugly mugs in there quite a lot. And guy came up to me in Topsham. He said, I heard you on the radio. I said, oh, that's good. He said, yeah. He said, you almost sounded intelligent. The spirit of David on your walk-in. And what else have we had lately? We were awarded honorary doctorates from Plymouth University. So now you're looking at Dr. Knightley, you know, Dr. Beer and Dr. Sykes. My wife's a GP, she wasn't very happy about this. Don't you ever call yourself a doctor, you know. I've tried it at airports and hotels, I haven't been upgraded yet, but you know. But mind you, she got really vexed by that Dr. Foster, I must admit. It was as if a doctor would give a patient drugs in a car park. You know? I said, that's how we met, but that's not the point. And Dr. Knightley, we were awarded the title of Greatest Ever Devonians 10 years ago. Last night in Miranda's house concert, there was the guy from Devon County Council whose idea it was. And he was going, that was me, you know. There was an online vote that they organised, I think with the Western Morning News. Your chance to vote for the greatest ever Devonians in the history of time. And they gave the reader a helpful list. Francis Drake, Babbage, father of computing, Agatha Christie, Chris Martin, and Joss Stone. We were noticeably absent from that list. But we were on tour and those bastards weren't. And so we may have just announced night after night that there was this online vote. And much to the bewilderment of Devon County Council, who never heard of us, we won! So then they thought, well, you know, we have to have some ceremony. So they awarded they said they'd present us with a Dartington crystal bowl, which I've still got, in Sanford. We'd been involved in the campaign to save the post office, and they thought that was the right location. So they got a camera crew from Plymouth and from Bristol. Western Morning News was there, and Express and Echo, and the Devon County Magazine. Some very experienced journalists in the back room of the Lamb in the middle of town. And they asked the chairman of the parish council, this elderly farmer, I think he was called Cyril, to present us with our prize. And he made the best presentation speech I've ever heard, because he came out and he goes, and we were standing there and the cameras were on, he said, I'd like to present these your boys. I'm sorry, I don't know your names. with whatever it is that's in this box, from whatever it was you're supposed to have done. Personally, I don't know. Anyway, there you go. And all these hardened journalists. It was the media highlight of our career. So I'll play you this song that I heard Martin play called The Seven Yellow Gypsies, because you can pick out the melody on this instrument. And he played it again with such amazing guitar playing using that dadgad tuning. And It's the classic Raggle Taggle Gypsy story. Probably the castle owner's worst nightmare. He set up his young bride in absolute luxury, and the gypsies come and they sing down in the street below. And she looks down and thinks, "Ooh, one of them looks like Poldark." And I don't know what's been going on in this marriage, but she's off. She's off with the gypsies. And the Lord comes home, saying, "Darling, I'm back." And the servants go, "Are you going to tell me? No, I'm not going to tell you." And he says, "Okay, get me my brown steed, because I'm going to go and find her. All I've got to do is talk sense, you know." It's funny, isn't it? It just reminds me of something. I'm going to leave you, but I want to see the facts and figures. Well, I'm just not happy. I want to see the facts and figures. You know, well, yeah, but what are your economic arguments for leaving me? Just not happy, I want to go. It's a bit like Brexit. Sometimes people act without facts and figures. They just have a feeling, and it's like, well, I'm going to go down to the riverside, and I'm going to lay out the economic arguments, and she's going to come back. She doesn't. But she says these most really cutting things to him. And you get the sense he'd probably ask for it somewhere down the line. Goes like this. Chances, they say, "Are you never home?" Because they see our tour dates. I work Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday normally. Because we don't work for fixed fees, we've never done this. Most bands work for a fixed fee. they need an agent who said, what's the most they can approach someone like that? The most we can get from this person. She's thinking, what's the least we could pay them to get them here? And we've taken all that out of the equation because we work for a percentage of what's left over. And that empowers people to put on gigs because there's no personal risk. Now, the received wisdom of the music business is no one's going to bother to promote it or advertise it if there's not the discipline of a big fat fee to tighten everything up. It's as if we would turn up here, or I'd turn up here, and there was only five people here. The pressure on Daff and the gang to make it full is much greater than any economic one, and that's what we've always relied on. So consequently, we don't tend to work Sunday, Monday or Tuesday because there's less people around going to see shows. Most bands do like tours and they work Sunday, Monday, Tuesday as well, and they're after a guarantee on the venue. Sometimes it's not a very high one, but it is a very, it is a bit of a compromising relationship, because if the venue is full up and it's a low guarantee, the band are going, oh shit, look at this, 200 people times 10 million, where are we getting that? Or if they've got a big guarantee and there's only about 20 people there, they're going, oh, thank goodness for that. And the poor promoter's going, so you can take that out of the equation totally. And we do, apart from festivals where there's a big lineup, where you try and get what you're worth and you try and get as much as you can. So consequently, Wednesday to Saturday is our normal working day week. And we'll do a tour, and I'm doing a tour now of maybe six of those, or seven of those long weekends, you know. Then there'll be festivals from June to September, maybe 25. I think we're playing Chagstock this year, which is nice. Playing Sidmouth as ever. Some festivals will put an exclusion on you. Say, if you do our festival, you cannot do anything within 60 miles with 2 months or a month other side. One of the biggest ones in Devon near Exeter does that. Well, that's how they try and get as many people. You can understand how it works, because there's an awful lot of bands on big guarantees. So then we come to the autumn, and we might do 20 or 30 dates. With bits and pieces in between, you're talking about 110 nights a year, which is not that demanding when you think about it. I said to a guy the other day, why don't you put all the days you go to work on a big poster? Now, how long would your tour be, you know? But what we do is we stand up here and everybody claps, which is great. You know, that's what nourishes you. And sometimes you need it, because combining family life with touring can be quite difficult. Not when it's not negotiable. It's difficult when you become professional, and perhaps the person you're with has to cope with a complete change in your lifestyle. But when you meet someone for whom it's not negotiable, then it's all fine. Until the inevitable dramas happen, you know. And some of them can be, you know, at one point I had 3 kids under 5. I remember a phone call from my wife. She had 3 snotty kids at midnight, driving them around a supermarket car park, trying to get them to sleep. She made the mistake of phoning me when I was in a cocktail bar in Winchester with Phil and Miranda and all the crew. And I'm going, yeah, no, I'll have a double, it'll be brilliant. And oh, no. Yes, brilliant. I'll catch up later. That's great. That's good. What's he doing? No, brilliant. And trying to get the two timescales back in sync is impossible. It's better in a way that those phone calls don't happen. No one gets to feel good, you know. And I've come back from festivals, big festival, maybe Crop Ready, 20,000 people. You know, and the applause is still ringing in my head. And I'll get back about 1 o'clock and my wife will go, you can have a little shit, I'm going to get some sleep. You know? And I'm standing there going, but I'm a folk god. Hello? Clap me, someone. It's a great leveler. And then, you know, in our particular case, there was quite a serious illness for my younger son. He had leukemia when he was 6, and lots of treatment. I said earlier, now he's a fine drummer, so he's got through all that. But for 3 or 4 years, it was very, very difficult to come and do this and stand here and be life and soul when you get a text in the interval saying, you have to get back after the gig because he's got an infection, you've got to get back to the RD&E, she's got to look after the other two, I have to drive through the night. And but I don't think it's any different, really, to what we all go through. And I always think, you know, in a room of 100 people, what amazing stories people could tell just in a room, you know, that make standing up here and going on and on about it, nothing. But it was great that everyone was there on the scene. It was so supportive and understanding. So I always think now that, you know, people say, I didn't want to bother you. Always bother. Should always cross the road and text and write and phone. Because it's as much as the applause, it makes such a difference. So this is the dive. And it happened between the Deer Leap Folk Club and the Tinnoff. One November's we left the docks, heading southwest from Morecambe Rocks. My dad and me, our 9 to 5, he used to steal while I used to dive. So over the side I slowly went down 100 below to where the sea water is brown. But after an hour I got low on air. When I surfaced again, well, his boat wasn't there. Cause my marker board must have come untied and drifted away with his boat at its side. He looked at his watch, 3 miles to the south, and he turned back again with his heart in his mouth. Soft rain on my face, sun almost set. I cut loose the weights, I let fall my nets. The lights on the shore were shining bright and clear. The cold was drifting in, and there was nobody . Was there ever a reel, a rod or a line that was so strong and true, so straight or so fine, as that tie that wound him through time and space? And he came out the darkness right to that place. We don't talk much about those days. Got 2 kids of my own now, 1 on the way. But if they're to grow, and if they're to thrive, 1 day they'll go, and 1 day they'll dive. And when they come up for light and for air, I hope someone's close, I hope someone's there. It's November noon, and we're leaving the docks. My son and me, we're just off Morecambe Rocks. Let's die. Thank you. Leicester. You must break free. When I was living in London, in the band, the coolest guy on the planet was Tom Robinson. The Tom Robinson band, they were just their attitude, their rock and roll, their amazing logo with a fist like that. And I got to know Tom quite well in the last few years. And he's a bit like a David Dolly. He has these nuggets of wisdom. He said, Steve, you know you like to tell these stories. Well, just because something's true doesn't make it interesting. I like that a lot. The other thing he said, you know, you just go off your last number, you come back straight away. You've got to leave it 5 minutes before you come back for your encore. You know. Tried that in Portsmouth, everybody had left. So I'm not going to risk that. So as you know, I don't know if any of you know the whole story about this venue. I'm going to tell you anyway. Daff was trying to book me for years for Village Halls. I never could quite get the dates right. The first time I did Grow Your Own gig, in 2014, I did 2 years of Village Halls, and all the songs were about countryside themes, like the folk songs, and we never could quite get the entry. Can we go do it? And a good entry. Now she can be quite persuasive. And then, after 2 years of that, I was going to do a tour called All at Sea. All of the gigs had to be maritime venues. And I was going to do nautical songs, like the dive, sea shanties, but they had to be so that you could just open the venue and there was the tide. So I said, I'm really sorry. It's maritime venues yet. So I got a text on Facebook that night, said, I have just formed the Widdicombe in the Moor Sailing Club. Now will you come and do this maritime venue? And I couldn't refuse. So the only non-nautical venue I did that entire tour about 3 years ago was this one. So I think, and now it's a venue. People come and play here. And I think with Mike and with everyone here, with Rob, she deserves an amazing round of applause. So give her a round of applause. What better room could you want in the middle of the moor? And, you know, for the fantastic food and for all the hospitality, I think the whole gang backstage there did even round of applause. So, that's the story of that. And as you know, I am the senior commanding officer here tonight. So if the bar is open afterwards, I do demand a drink. So, I played this song called Hard Shoulder. I didn't realise, it was one of those songs, when I was putting this is like a story, this whole show, really. It took quite a long time to try and get the narrative right. And this was requested one night, and it was only as I was singing the song, I realised that every verse referred to something that I'd been spouting on about all night. It mentions going back to school in the county, there's a little bit of rugby there. There's the power of music to give people renewal. You know the way that sportsmen don't tend to come back? Musicians do, it's amazing. Yeah. They just have to get through their 40s with dignity. Not everybody makes it. But the first verse is about the disastrous band from London when we did a gig at an agricultural college near Bridgewater. The day after they finished for the term, and no one was there, and there was lots of arguments, lots of recriminations. And then it talks about playing in pubs. And then it says at the end, look, you can always start again. You know, you can always find yourself through music again. You can be better than ever. And it's true, I've seen bands lately, they've never played as well. If they get in touch with that thing that they wanted when they were teenagers, that thing they wanted, not just to be clapped and stay up late, but just to communicate. And you know, we were out the wrong side of the Avon when the old man gave up the fight. You pulled your bags from the back seat. You left me there. You walked into the night. You know, I didn't mind picking up the pieces, sorting out the gear and waiting for the light. But standing there on that hard shoulder, I lost the strength to make things right. You know, we go back to school in the county. We were the first in line for the back of the class, or out on the fields looking for action in the heart of a scrum. There was a punch and a laugh, but you left when you were 16, and I stayed on for that safety net. And it broke my fall on that cold morning. You were falling then. I wonder, have you landed yet? There's no surprise, there's no mystery. What we are or where we're from. Our lives and our history are so. In the bars all along the coast. So I parked the car and I heard you singing. My face at the window must have looked like a ghost. So many songs we wrote together, no compromise we used to boast. But to hear you play all that boy band trash, well, that's what really gets to me the most. There's no surprise, there's no mystery. What you are, or where you're from. There's no lie, no in this song. Well, I once said, if you don't use it, you'll live one day. If I become, well, I see your guitar still standing in the corner. Why don't you come around and prove me wrong? So we might be a little older now, but you know the heartbeat, well, it's still as strong. And anyway, still got a hard shoulder that you might need to lean upon. There's no surprise, no mystery. What we are is where we're from. Here's our life and our history. Here's our song. Ooh, our song. This is no surprise. This is no mystery. No surprise.
Thank you.
Welcome, Sailing Club, Rear Admiral T-shirt.
Well, you can reuse it for all sorts of things, just don't throw it in the sea.
I've just thought of a really good idea for you. Thank you very much.